I'm a man! I'm 40!
Welcome to the Big 12, a four-part series unraveling the history of the conference. Since football is king, as far as college athletics are concerned, this series will focus on football. Sorry, Kansas and Baylor. To kick off, the Big 12 wouldn't be here without the merger of two conferences, the Big 8 and the Southwest Conference. So, this episode, we tell the story of how 8 plus 9 became 12.
Quick mess!
Our story starts with the NVIAA, founded in 1907. This conference would become the Big 8 in 1957 with the addition of Oklahoma State, who, at the time, was Oklahoma A&M, but understandably needed to change. The Big 8 was formed with 8 teams who would all eventually become founding members of the Big 12. This conference was quite successful on the gridiron. Oklahoma won 6 national championships, Nebraska won 4, and even Colorado won one of their own. And it was a relatively peaceful abode out in the middle of nowhere. But then, there was the Southwest Conference. Founded in 1914, the Southwest Conference was one of the most storied conferences in the land, up until the Watergate scandal. In the 1930s, SMU, TCU, and Texas A&M all won national championships, and you might as well give the 1954 A&M team another one for surviving Bear Bryant's reenactment of hell. In the 1960s, Arkansas would win a national title, and Texas would win 3 of their own under legendary head coach Darrell K. Royal, in case you forgot their stadium name. These would be the last championships the conference would ever win. From 1956 onwards, the Southwest Conference had 8 members, 7 Texas teams plus Arkansas. 4 of those Texas schools were private universities, and at least 3 of them would have a big issue coming soon. The NFL is coming to Texas with not just one, but 2 teams, the Houston Oilers and America's team, the Dallas Cowboys. Houston was actually in the AFL, but in 1970, which coincidentally was the last time the Southwest Conference ever won a national title, the AFL-NFL merger happens. This was the beginning of the end for the Southwest Conference. By 1974, the cracks were already showing. According to a Texas Monthly article, a Texas official says Texas was practically subsidizing the conference, and to be fair, they kind of were. Link to the article in the description. But to sum it up, attendance was crumbling in the Texas private schools. Baylor is mentioned, but the focus is more on Rice and Houston, TCU right outside of Dallas, and particularly SMU, who used to be the big attraction in Dallas. These athletic departments are dependent on football revenue, and especially back then, ticket sales were absolutely vital. Texas and the other public schools like Texas A&M, Arkansas, and Texas Tech were giving up a decent amount of their football revenue to the conference to keep it afloat. Texas wasn't having it, and the article even mentions the possibility of becoming an independent or, foreshadowing alert, joining a super conference to be more profitable. It's okay though. 2 years later, another public school, their 9th and final member, would begin playing football in the Southwest. Houston, yet another team in Texas, would save the conference.
Psych!
Oh, about that Texas Monthly article that called out SMU? Yeah, SMU got good, real good, in the early 80s. Like, too good to be true. Now, they didn't win a national championship, as their undefeated 1982 season was spoiled by a 17-17 tie to Arkansas, but they posted 5 straight 10-plus win seasons. So, what's the catch?
College football tonight has a new scandal. Once again, it involves Southern Methodist University.
Shady recruiting practices.
Recruiting violations.
Illegal payments.
One SMU player said he was given money to play.
The culture of this city was that, well, if we're going to cheat, we're going to show you how to cheat. If we're going to pay, we're going to really pay.
The death penalty. The only one ever in college football history. But it wasn't just SMU. Schools across the conference were paying players and couldn't help but to snitch on each other. The Southwest Conference would never ever contend for a national title again. Literally everyone in the conference except two schools were hit with NCAA sanctions for recruiting violations. Care to guess who wasn't? Rice, of course, and Arkansas, the only non-Texas team in the conference. Since an outsider? Much like the USSR in the late 80s and early 90s, the Southwest Conference was collapsing. Forget the cracks in the conference, the foundation was now crumbling to pieces. Top recruits called the Southwest Conference shaky, screwed up, or getting into too much trouble. The NCAA didn't even allow schools on probation to appear on TV at the time. The final eight conference champs from 1988 to 1995 would lose their bowl games, recruiting, revenue, and performance, all gone. Well, the newcomer to the conference, Houston, did see quarterback Andre Ware win the Heisman in 1989 at least. There was another development though. 1984 Supreme Court case, NCAA versus Board of Regents of the University of Oklahoma. Thanks, OU. The Supreme Court said the NCAA, which had owned all broadcasting rights for college football since the early 50s, could not prevent schools or conferences from pursuing their own television deals. So, 63 of the biggest schools formed the short-lived CFA, or College Football Association, to negotiate with television networks themselves. But, with the rise of cable television, the biggest fish couldn't be held back. In 1991, Notre Dame left the CFA and negotiated their own exclusive deal with NBC, which still exists today. Another conference had a similar idea. In February 1994, the SEC was split from the CFA and signed a massive $95 million contract with CBS, which also still exists today. The rest of college football followed, and the CFA folded in 1997. But did you notice someone in that intro? Remember the outsider of the Southwest Conference?
SEC Commissioner Roy Kramer officially offered an invitation to join the SEC to Arkansas this afternoon. And in a unanimous 10-0 vote by the Arkansas Board of Trustees, it was accepted.
Bye, Felicia.
In 1990, Arkansas would be invited to the SEC, along with Independent South Carolina, to form a 12-team conference starting in 1992, which would feature two divisions and the first ever conference championship game in college football history. But Arkansas wouldn't be the last to go. In fact, according to Arkansas Athletic Director Frank Broyles, Texas and Texas A&M wanted Arkansas to leave to destabilize the conference so that they could dip as well without facing as much backlash from Texans and especially Texas politicians. More on them later. Not that Arkansas really needed any convincing to leave, but the remaining big dogs of the conference, Texas and Texas A&M, wanted out. The smaller private schools of the conference had a solution though. Why not replace Arkansas with an available private school like BYU or Tulane? You can guess what Texas and A&M thought of that. To them, at least, the conference and its reputation were broken beyond repair, and they looked elsewhere. Texas A&M had actually been flirting with the SEC since the late 80s. Why wouldn't they? The bigger question is, why wouldn't Texas? They clearly do now. Well, UT's Robert Birdall, who was the president of the university at the time, had some choice words about the SEC. I guess Texas was just too smart for the SEC and the likes of Vanderbilt. Instead, Texas approached the Big Ten, but the Big Ten didn't want to expand. So, Texas wanted the Pac-10 and would negotiate heavily, but for some reason, they were pretty much ghosted. With Texas out, Texas A&M would try to go to the SEC with Houston. The SEC wasn't too excited about that.
Who?
Remember the Big Eight? Unlike the Southwest Conference, the Big Eight had it together, on and off the field. In 1995, the Big Eight had four teams ranked top 10 in the nation, and that didn't even include Oklahoma. At the time, teams in the Southwest Conference could only dream of being in the top 10. Under head coach Tom Osborne, Nebraska won back-to-back national championships in 1994 and 1995. Surely, they were doing all right. Well, there's a problem. Even before Arkansas and South Carolina joined the SEC, the conference already had 18% of the nation's television revenue. The Big Eight, out in the Great Plains, only had 8.1%. TV was becoming huge, and conferences now had to negotiate their own deals with networks. Former Kansas State president John Wefeld even feared that Oklahoma may join the SEC in search of greater revenue, so the Big Eight had to make a move. Well, there weren't a whole lot of options, but what about the Southwest Conference? Sure, they were in a bit of a hole, but Texas and Texas A&M would be massive additions to the conference and could incentivize schools like Oklahoma to stay put. Each conference had 8 teams, so how about a merger? Nah, forget the smaller schools. Texas and Texas A&M could ditch the rest of the conference like they wanted to and form the other Big Ten conference. Don't worry about coming up with a name for such a 10-team conference, though. Remember those Texas politicians? They got to work. It's politicking time. Enter Texas Governor Ann Richards, a Baylor grad. Apparently she wasn't really involved in the process. But State Senator David Sibley, also a Baylor grad and former mayor of Waco, was certainly involved. You know what's even more powerful than the governor of the state of Texas, though? Lieutenant Governor Bob Bullock, a Texas Tech grad, worked with Sibley, as well as John Montford, Texas State Senator of Lubbock, who would later be the Chancellor of Texas Tech, all called a meeting on February 20th, 1994, and sure enough, a deal would be worked out. No, not a 16-team merger, but Texas Tech and Baylor weren't getting left behind. On February 25th, 1994, Texas, Texas A&M, Texas Tech, and Baylor would join forces with the Big Eight. They would, however, not be joining the Big Eight Conference, but forming a new conference. Remember that for later. Anyway, you'll never guess what they called it. The two oldest remaining conferences in college football, outside the Big Ten and the Pac-10, would be dissolved after the Big 12 commenced play in 1996. The 12-team conference would mirror the SEC's two-division format with a championship game of their own. The South Division would unite the states of Texas and Oklahoma, while the North Division was, well, everything north of that. Oh, also, the headquarters are moving from Kansas City to Irving, Texas. No big deal. The Big 12 wasn't done with the negotiations yet, though. Reports came out that they were still considering expanding to 14 or 16 to secure a larger TV share. Remember that the SEC already had 18% of the nation's television audience even without Arkansas and South Carolina. The Big Eight had 8.1%, and the entire Southwest Conference only at 6.7. Candidates for expansion included New Mexico, Louisville, and Memphis, but the closest additions were BYU and Southwest Conference leftover TCU. Remember those teams for later, especially the latter. The Big 12 decided to stick with 12, though, and the remaining teams from the Southwest Conference, TCU, SMU, Rice, and Houston, the four schools from Houston and DFW, where the NFL took over, were kicked to the curb. Houston, the lone public school left out, would go to Conference USA. The three private schools would head to the WAC. Today, Rice has found its place in Conference USA. Houston and SMU would later reunite in the Young American Athletic Conference, and we'd hear more from Houston later. Next episode, we will relive the short-lived glory hours of the conference with its original 12 members. Enjoy while it lasts, because the Big 12 would peak before you knew it. Oh, what about TCU? They'd move from the WAC to Conference USA and then to the Mountain West. And let's just say, TCU worked their way back up.
One for the ages. A failed two-point conversion is all that kept us from going to overtime. And there's the offensive hero of the game, Andy Dalton. And of course, Tank Carter, the linebacker, the young man who broke his back in an automobile accident, took up football late and came in and made the play of his life. At the age of 10, He was a BMC champion, and now today he's a Rose Bowl champion.